Jesus, what am I going to do tonight? You know, I'm so, you know what I mean? But he was the guy who you could entrust to do anything like that. And that's what opened the door for him to become a youth pastor. Now he's leading the whole family ministries department, youth, children, everything in our North Campus. And God's just opening doors for him all around the place. Why? Because it's a test of faithfulness. Friend, if you want to develop character in your life and the kind of character that will sustain you into the fullness of the plan that God has for you, let me tell you, build faithfulness in your life. Be faithful with your giving. Be faithful with your serving. Be faithful with your life groups. Be faithful with church. Be faithful with showing up here on a Sunday. You know, I shared this morning that again about faithfulness, how faithfulness is a big quality that I hold highly in my life. And it's such to the point that I've been a Christian for 15 years. I've been in this church 15 years. I got saved at 18, 33 this year. You know, Pastor Luke, who's an incredible man of God, has been my pastor that whole time. Do you know, not once in those 15 years has Pastor Luke ever tapped his foot and gone, I wonder where Steve is. Haven't seen him for a while. Not once, because I'm here all the time. I'm faithful. I believe the call of God. I believe God's plan over my life, and I believe in this church. And so not once is he here to wonder, I wonder where Steve is. No. Faithfulness, friend. Faithfulness is the thing that builds the character in your life that you need to go into the fullness of what God has for you. My second thought is this. How do we develop character? My second thought is this. Now, hopefully this doesn't get lost in any translation, but this is my point. Allow the word of God to cut you. And let me explain what I mean by that. Allow the word of God to cut you. Hebrews chapter 4 says this. I'll give you a moment to find it in your Bibles. Hebrews chapter 4. Do you know Hebrews was the only book written by a New Zealander, a Kiwi? Hebrews. Hebrew. Okay. I'm just kidding, by the way. That was a joke. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 12 says this. Indeed, the word of God, listen to this, let this sink in. The word of God is living and active. It's sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. Do you hear that? Let's go back to that last bit. If you like to underline your Bible, please underline that last little bit. I like to underline and highlight in my Bible. It is able to judge the thoughts and intentions of the heart. See, this is what happens. When you allow the Word of God into your life, when you take His Word and you don't just look at it and then put it away, and you don't just leave it on. You know, sometimes our Bibles can become like coffee coasters on our bedside tables, you know? You know, put your coffee cup on there and you're going to blow the dust off the covers. You know, when you allow the Word of God, the Bible says here in Hebrews chapter 4, says that the Word of God is sharp. It divides things. It can cut in. And what I mean when I say you've got to allow the Word of God to cut you, what I mean is this. When you read the Word of God, you have to allow it to come in and divide in you the intentions and the thoughts of your heart. Because the Word of God, when you allow it to do that, will reveal in you thoughts, mindsets, motivations, and character which is not right. It'll show you as you read it, it'll start to cut things in your life. You go, oh man, that the way I'm thinking about that, the way I'm behaving, the way I'm operating, the way I'm speaking, it doesn't line up with the Word of God. And when you allow it to cut you, it divides the very thoughts and intentions of your heart. And so what you find is you find you've been thinking a certain thing about a person, you've been behaving a certain way, and then you read the Word of God. I don't know, maybe it's just me. This happens to me all the time, where I'm sitting there reading the Word of God, and then the Word of God just starts to cut into those thoughts and intentions of my heart, and it starts to show me, Steve, that's not right. That mindset's not right. That behavior that you've been exhibiting to those people, that's not right. The way you've been speaking to that person, that's not right. You know what? You know why it's called a sword? Because it cuts things, and when it cuts things, it can be a bit painful. You know what I'm saying? Because it means you've got to change. It means you've got to start living a little bit differently. But when you allow the Word of God into your life, it starts to divide in your life the things that are of God and the things that are not of God. The things that, the way that God wants you to live your life and the way that He doesn't want you to live your life. And it begins to separate those things out. And as you allow it to do that, you can then start to align your life more in line with the life that God is calling you to live. And that, friends, will build character in your heart. See, too often we take the Word of God and we read it, then we put it down, and that's as far as it goes. You know, I find a lot of Christians, they like to read the Bible, but it's just like, you know, it's like your religious to-do list. You know, pray, tick the box, read my Bible, tick the box. But if I asked you an hour after you read your Bible, what did you read today? So many people I've met, they would have no idea what they just read, because they haven't allowed it to come in and cut them. They haven't allowed it to come and speak to their heart. See, reading the Bible is not just the religious duty, you know, tick the box and then God's really happy with you. You know, God's so pleased with me. I read 3 chapters today. What did it say? I don't know, but I read it. See, it's so much more than that. So much more than that. I wrote a little devotional guide book thing. It's for sale at the bookshop here. I wrote that intentionally because I wanted to teach people how to read the Bible so that it's not just reading it, but it's allowing it to come and shape your lives. Because when you allow the Word of God, which is the most amazing and beautiful thing on planet Earth, when you allow that to come and shape who you are, it leads you into the fullness of life. And it leads you into a place with God, which is just incredible. And I'll tell you, friend, if you want to develop character in your life, to fulfill the fullness of the plan that God has for you, friend, you've got to allow the Word of God to cut you. You've got to allow it into your heart, into your mind. The Bible says that, this is in Romans chapter 8, that to allow God to change you into a new person by changing the way you think. Transform you by changing the way you think. How does He change the way you think? By allowing the Word of God to come and divide the very thoughts and intentions of your heart. Come and let it come and let it divide. And look, I know it's painful. It's painful when you want to hold on to unforgiveness, but God is saying forgive. It's painful when that word comes in. Oh, I don't want to do that. That hurts. It's painful when you are thinking someone else is the problem, and then you read the Word of God and it cuts you and it shows you that you're the problem, not them. You know what I mean? I've had that happen a few times. Thank you, Jesus. Whereas when you allow it to, though, it starts to refine who you are and build your character. And character is the thing you need to go to wherever God is calling you to go and do whatever God is calling you to do. If you want the strength of character in your life to fulfill it, if you want enough fuel in the tank to finish the job, then friends, you have to be willing to allow the Word of God to come in and cut your life, to shape it, to divide things, to cut things out, and to show you the things that He wants in your life and things that He doesn't want. My last thought is this. How do you develop character? It's very simple. You need to serve others, not yourself. If you want to build the kind of character in your life that is going to sustain you into the fullness of what God has for you, you need to serve others, not just yourself. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Open your Bibles to that. 1 Corinthians chapter 10. Very simple passage in verse 24. It says this: don't be concerned for your own good, but for the good of others. Don't be concerned just for your own good. Be concerned for the good of other people. See, we live in a very selfish world, very selfish society. Just about what you can get, what you can have, you getting more, others getting less. No. The Bible's teaching a totally different way. See, don't live like that. Don't live your life selfish. Don't live like it's just about what I can have. No. Don't look just for your own good. Look for the good of other people as well. We had a panel discussion where we had a few of our leaders and things on a panel, and people were asking us questions. And one of the questions that people asked this panel, and my wife Bex was on the panel as well, and I was there. One of the questions was, what has been one of the key factors in your continued growth as a Christian? What is it? What do you think is one of the most defining factors in your growth as a Christian? And she answered it. I didn't answer it, but she answered it. But I felt she answered it for me as well, because it was the exact same thing as I would have said. She said this very simply. The main thing, the main driver to her growth and my growth as a Christian has been simply learning to serve other people. Serve other people. And when you serve other people, it breaks out of your life a selfish mindset. It breaks out of your life a selfish pride and the character that all those attributes that shouldn't be there. When you learn to put yourself aside and give your life in service of other people, it deals with a whole lot of stuff and it keeps your eyes focused on the most important thing. See, when you serve other people, let me tell you, it's gonna be testing. It's gonna be trying, it's gonna be tough, it's gonna be hard sometimes. You're gonna find yourself incredibly frustrated because you have to deal with other people, right? Like, and other people are fantastic, but they're other people and they have problems. Like, the church would be fantastic if it wasn't for all the people. They'll bring problems, you know? But when you have to serve alongside and give your life for other people, friend, you'll find yourself tested, you find it trying, you find all these different things will start to test your faith and your character. But what it does do is it reveals some stuff in you again that God wants to deal with. It might reveal pride, it might reveal arrogance, it might reveal selfishness, all those kinds of things. But as you learn to give your life in service for other people, friend, you'll find your character starts to be more and more developed. And when you focus your life on serving other people with your life, not just yourself, what it does is it builds a selfless character in you, where it's not about you, it's not about what you can get, it's not about your goodness and your gifting and your arrogance and your pride. No. It's about what God has done in you that you can give and bless other people with. See, this is the thing. The fullness of the plan that God has for you is outworked within the context of the body. See, I'll say that again. The fullness of the plan that God has for your life, the fullness of His giftings, the fullness of the purpose that He has for you, the fullness of His call is all found within the context of community, of the body. See, the fullness of God's plan for you is not found with you in isolation. It's not found with you just doing your own thing on your own. No. We work together. There's an incredible unity and strength that comes when I work in my gift and Pastor Vicky works in his gift. And when we start to do that, there's this incredible thing called the body of Christ, which starts to be one of the most phenomenal forces on planet Earth when we all start working like that. But it comes and it begins from a heart of serving other people, not ourselves, and allowing the character that God wants to build in us to be refined and developed. See, I really believe there's people in this room that God has called to do extraordinary things. God's, there's some church leaders in here, there's future Tamil campuses in here, there's church planters, there's all kinds of people sitting in this room. But you will never know the fullness of that unless you can build in your life a godly character. Character is your number one priority. If you can't learn to serve other people, if you can't allow God to refine you in that, if you can't allow the word to come in and to shape your life and to cut you, if you can't do these kinds of things, you're never going to make it to and see the fullness of what God has for you. Because somewhere along the line, you're going to run out of fuel. Somewhere along the line, your gifting might take you a certain way. You might be incredibly gifted to preach. That's fantastic. Do you have the character inside you to sustain your gift? You might be gifted to lead. You might be a gifted worshiper. That's fantastic. It's a gift of God. But do you have the character inside you that will sustain the gifting and the call that God has over your life? See, God's main concern, and I really believe it's His main concern, and so it should be our main concern, is our heart and our character. That's what God wants for our lives. I really want to encourage you, friends. I want to challenge you, though, to make character, make godly character your number one priority. It's not about how great you are, how gifted you are, how able you are, how much passion you have. They're all fantastic things, but they will only take you so far. And then you'll find yourself like my lawnmower, cutting out partway along, and you'll never quite finish. You'll never quite get to the fullness of what God has for you. Because, not because of a lack of trying, gifting, calling, but because of a lack of character. I still talk about this, you know, without character, there's no internal to support your external. says, you've got a nice outlook, nice shell, but there's nothing inside driving that. And so it's kind of like the difference between a plane, like an airplane, and a glider. You know a glider? There's no engines on it. So both of them can fly, but only one of them can sustain flight on its own. The other one is totally dependent on external factors. There's no internal factors which are helping to drive that. Sooner or later, that's going to come down. Friends, you've got to build the internal, the combustion, the internal that is supporting your external. Otherwise, soon enough, you'll find yourself, the wheels will start to fall off and everything will start to crash and burn. Can we stand together? I'd love to pray for everybody today. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I thank you for an incredible group of people. Thank you for your grace and your love for them. God, thank you that in this room there are church planters, that there are missionaries. God, that there are husbands and wives, that there are people who are raising the next generation. God, I thank you that in this room there are prayers. Lord, that in this room there are intercessors, there are worshippers. God, I thank you that each one of them has an incredible call of God upon their life. God, I thank you that you do have a plan and a purpose for them. But God, I pray right now in Jesus' name that in this room we would make a decision and a determination that character would become our highest priority. God, we may be incredibly gifted. We may have the ability to do what it is you're calling us to do. But I know that unless we are diligent and we are able to build within us the character we need to do what you've called us to do, we will find ourselves coming up short. And so, Lord, I pray right now in Jesus' name, if there is any area of character where we're lacking right now, I pray right now, Holy Spirit, you reveal that to the hearts of the people in this room. God, if there's one thing, if there's something that we're not doing right, if there's one thing that we're missing, if there's one area in our lives that you're speaking to us about right now, I just pray right now, Holy Spirit, you reveal that to us right now. God, show us the one thing that we can work on. Show us the one thing in us that we need to start doing better with, Lord God. I just pray that right now in Jesus' name, that you give us the wisdom, the strategy, and the boldness to make some decisions, to make some calls, and to make some changes. God, I pray that you would build in us a heart of faithfulness, Lord God, that we would be faithful in our giving, faithful in our serving, faithful in our marriages, faithful with our kids. God, I pray, Lord, that you would help us to allow the Word of God not just to be something that we look at from time to time, but it would be the foundation on which our life is built. Lord, we allow it to come in, and like it says of itself, that it is sharper than any two-edged sword, dividing the very thoughts and intentions of our heart. Lord, that we would be a people that allow it to cut us, allow it to come in and show us the things in our life that aren't right, that aren't straight with you, Lord God. And Lord, I pray that we would always have a heart that our lives are not about ourselves, but about serving other people. And that in that, Lord God, you would build a strength of character that will sustain us into what you have for us, Lord God. Father, I bless each person here in this room in the name of Jesus. Amen. 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 Thank you so much, Pastor Biggie.
வார்த்தை பேசப்பட்டது. அழகாக சொன்னார் வந்து, தேவன் விரும்பும் குணாதிசயங்கள், தேவனுடைய திட்டத்தை செய்ய வேண்டுமா இருந்தால் தேவன் விரும்புகிற குணாதிசயங்கள் நம் வாழ்க்கையிலே கடந்து வர வேண்டும் என்று மூன்று காரியங்களை குறித்து பேசுகிறான். ஒன்று வந்து, நாம் உண்மையும் உத்தமமாய் இருக்கும் போது தேவன் நம்முடைய வாழ்க்கையில் அவருடைய குணாதிசயத்தை கொண்டு வருகின்றார். இரண்டாவது காரியம், தேவனுடைய வார்த்தை நம்முள்ளே கிரிய செய்யும் போது நம்முடைய இதயத்தின் நினைவுகள், தோற்றங்கள் எல்லாவற்றையும் வகையறக்கூடிய அந்த வார்த்தையானது நம்முடைய வாழ்க்கையில சில காரியங்களை நீக்கி தேவன் விரும்புகிற ஒரு பிள்ளையாக என்னை உங்களையும் மாற்றும். மூன்றாவது, மற்றவருக்கு உதவி செய்யும் போது நம்மை தேவன் உருவாக்குற. இரண்டாவது, சுயநலங்கள் பெருமைகள் எல்லாம் அகன்று போகும்போது நாம் தேவனுடைய பிள்ளைகளாக மாறுகிறோம். அப்படி நாம் செய்யாவிட்டால், நம்முடைய தேவனுடைய சாயலே தேவனுடைய குணாதிசை நாம் மாறாவிட்டால், தேவன் என்னுடைய உங்களுடைய வாழ்க்கையில வைத்திருக்கிற திட்டத்தை சரியாக செய்ய முடியாதபடி நாங்கள் பாதியிலே நின்று விடுவோம். ஆண்டவர், இந்த மாலை விடையில தேவன் அருமையாக வார்த்தை பேசியிருப்பதனால் இந்த வார்த்தையின்படி ஆண்டவர் எங்கள் வாழ்க்கையை நாங்கள் ஒப்புக் கொடுக்க போன சொல்லுவோமாக. தகப்பனே, நீர் அருமையான இந்த மாலை வேலைக்காக நன்றி செலுத்துகிறோம். அப்பா, கிருபை நிறைந்த உங்களுடைய வார்த்தைக்காக நன்றி செலுத்துகிறோம். எங்கள் ஒவ்வொருடைய வாழ்க்கையிலும் உங்களுடைய அனாதி தீர்மானங்கள், திட்டங்கள் ஆண்டவரே எங்கள் வாழ்க்கையில இருப்பதற்காக நன்றி என்று சொல்லுகிறோம் ஐயா.
எங்களை தாழ்த்தி உம்முடைய சமூகத்தில் ஒப்பு கொடுக்கிறோம். நீர் விரும்புகிற வண்ணமாக ஆண்டவரே எங்களை நீர் உருவாக்கி எங்கள் மத்தியில கிரிய செய்கிற நல்ல ஆண்டவரை உம்மை துதிக்கிறோம். அப்பா, எங்கள் வாழ்க்கையில் ஆண்டவரை உண்மையும் உத்தமமாக ஆண்டவரை உம்மை பின்பற்றத்தக்கதாக எங்கள் வாழ்க்கையில நீர் ஆண்டவரை கிருப தர வேண்டுமா நாங்கள் ஜெபிக்கிறோம். உம்முடைய வார்த்தை எங்கள் இதயத்திலே கிரிய செய்யும்படியாக ஒப்பு கொடுக்கிறோம். அப்பா, தேவையில்லாத நினைவுகள், சிந்தனைகள், எண்ணங்கள் எல்லாவற்றையும் ஊடுருவ வகையறுக்க கூடிய உம்முடைய வார்த்தையானதாண்டு வர என் வாழ்க்கையில கிரிய செய்யட்டும். அப்பொழுது நான் நீர் விரும்புகிற வண்ணமாக உம்முடைய நீர் உருவாக்குற மகனாக மகளாக ஆண்டவரே நான் மாறும்படி என்னை மாற்றி வைக்கிறவரை உம்மை துதிக்கிறேன், உம்மை மகிமைப்படுத்துகிறேன். நான் மற்றவருக்கு உதவி செய்யும் போது ஆண்டவரே என்னுடைய சுயநலம் முன்னுக்கு வராதபடி, பெருமை முன்னுக்கு வராதபடி ஆண்டவரே நான் என்னை தாழ்த்தி ஆண்டவரே மற்றவருக்கு உதவி செய்யும் போது நீர் எப்படி இந்த பூமியிலே வந்து உதவி செய்தீரோ ஆண்டவரே அப்படிப்பட்ட குணாதிசயத்தை கொடுக்கிற கர்த்தாவை உம்மை துதி நன்றி செலுத்துகிறோம். ஒவ்வொருடைய வாழ்க்கையிலும் வந்திருக்க திட்டங்கள், செயல்கள் ஒரு போதும் ஆண்டவரே எதிரியானவன் பறித்து விடாதபடி எங்களை தாழ்த்தி உம்முடைய சமூகத்தில் ஒப்பு கொடுக்கிறோம். அப்பா, பாசசீவுக்காக ஜெபிக்கிறோம். கொடுத்த வார்த்தைக்காக நன்றி செலுத்துவோம். தேவ பிரசன்னத்துக்காக ஆண்டவருடைய சமூகத்தில் வருகிறோம். ஆண்டவரே வந்து ஒவ்வொரு பிள்ளைகளை இந்த வார்த்தையின் அடிப்படையில் ஆசீர்வதிக்கிற ஆண்டவரே இது ஒவ்வொரு குடும்பத்துக்கும் தனிப்பட்ட பிள்ளைகளுக்கும் வைத்திருக்க ஒவ்வொரு திட்டங்களும் இயேசுவின் நாமத்தினால் ஆண்டவரே மகிமையாக நிறைவேறும்படியாக ஒப்பு கொடுக்கிறோம். நல்ல போராட்டத்தை போராடினேன் ஆண்டவரை, நான் காத்து கொண்டேன், என் கர்த்தர் வரும்போது எனக்கு நீதியும் கிரீடத்தை கொடுப்பார் என்று பவுல் சொன்ன வண்ணமாக ஆண்டவரே விசுவாசத்தை ஓடத்தக்கதான கிருபைகளை கொடுப்பீராக. தனிமையான மாறுவளைக்கு நன்றி. எங்களை தாழ்த்தி ஒப்புக் கொடுக்கிறோம். துதியும் கனமும் மகிமும் ஒக்கே செலுத்தி மீட்பர் இயேசு மூலம் நன்றி செலுத்தி எபிக்கிறோம் எங்கள் அருமப்பிதாவே. ஆமே. எல்லோரும் சேர்ந்து சொல்லுமாக, என் ஆத்மாவே கர்த்தரே சோத்ரி, உடனே பெருசு நாமத்தை சோத்ரி, ஆத்மாவே கர்த்தரே சோத்ரி, கர்த்த சேசரம் ஆசிரியர் பெற்றுக்கொள்ளமாக கர்த்தராகிய இயேசுவின் கிருபையும் பிதாவாய் தேவனுடைய அன்பும் பரிசுத்தாவின் ஐக்கியமும் இரண்டு மகளுடனும் மீட்பர் இயேசு கிறிஸ்து வரும் வரை நம்மளிருப்பதாக. ஆமென். பந்தையாவுக்கு நன்றி. உரை வாழ்த்து விடுவோமாக.